Okay, you're live.
ओके जी, ग्रेट, थैंक यू।
मैं चैट पे वो कर रहा हूँ जो लिंक। ठीक है, ओके। हाँ
ओके अजय, थैंक यू सो मच।
आई थिंक वी मे बी एक्सपेक्टिंग निशा ऑल्सो, राइट?
यस, विल वेट फॉर 2 मिनट्स, देन वी कैन गो अहेड।
ओके।
ओके
You can now give me access for sharing the screen.
Sure. It's me. Okay, host is me. Okay. Just check, Santosh. You should be having the access now.
Yes.
Okay.
Let me see. Share screen. Yeah.
Okay, great.
I think you will be able to see my screen.
Yeah, it's visible. Nice presentation, by the way.
Okay, thank you.
Santosh, I think we can start. Nizam will join in the meantime, in case it joins.
Okay, no issues. We'll go ahead. Okay.
Go ahead. Okay. Thank you so much. Okay, Sarath?
Okay.
Sarath, you are there? Okay, Nizam has joined as well. Hi, Nizam. Hi, Sarath. Good afternoon.
Hello, sir.
Hi, sir.
Sarat, this is going to be the last session for CA Foundations from BCISAI for this attempt. Going forward, we'll have another classes. For that, we'll share the schedule with you. Today's class will be taken by CA Santosh TV. He is the vice chairperson of our BCISAI community. So for that, good luck to you, all of you. And rest, I give the handover back to Santosh. He'll take care of it. Thank you so much, Santosh, for taking the class.
Thank you, Vivek. Hi, Sarath and Nisam. Hope you are doing good. If you don't have any issues from your side, I have no problem. You are unmuting. If at all we face an issue, we can mute at that time. Absolutely no problem. This class can be as interactive as possible. Also, I am sure this is something like miscellaneous session, at least the second part. And first part only, then one section is there, a regular one. What I mean is that this is I think part A, you have paper 4, part A, business economics, which was classes are taken by Vivek and Pushpu. And part B, this one, business and commercial knowledge. Three sections are yesterday, Sandeep has taken, business environment, business organization, and government policies. I hope that you have a fair idea about all those things. Today, the rest of the section, we will be covering today. Okay. One is that organization facilitating business and the common commercial attempts. Okay. Let me go ahead, right? You are fine, right? You are hearing?
Yes, sir. I think we are fine.
Okay. Okay, in the today's topic content, I already discussed these are the major areas which we'll be covering. One is the organizations facilitating business. Mostly, there are organizations facilitating businesses are two types. One is funding organization, which is giving an economic support to that organization. Another are non-funding institutions. Okay, and we will cover these things in detail in the coming section. And with regards to common business terminologies, I am planning to cover these areas like finance, stock and commodity section, marketing, banking and other business. In the organization facilitating business, maybe we will cover a couple of financial supporting organizations and then some non-financial organizations. Okay, in the financial sector, one is that is a NABARD, National Bank for Agriculture and Rural Development. Like that, there are many other organizations also, which I think our subject is not covering much on the other organization. Maybe a few I can name for you for your understanding. One is SIDBI and the Small Industries Development Bank of India. Another is one very old organization called IFCI. It is Industrial Finance Corporation of India, which is established in 1948. And some other organizations also there previously, it is ICICI Bank. Before that, it is called ICICI. It is Industrial Credit Investment Corporation of India. Even IDBI for that matter, it is like that similar organization, which was funding exclusively for businesses. Okay. This is the fundamental background of the financial organization. These are the set of organizations which is financial in nature for a business, it's for facilitating a business. There are other classification, non-financial. In non-financial also, there are a few commercial banks also financial. Non-funding organizations are certain regulatory authorities. For that, RBI is one such example. In that also, there are some regulators are industry specific. It's called Insurance Regulatory Authority of India. Another is maybe TRAI, Telecom Regulatory Authority of India. Maybe if you heard, there is something called Spices Board. If you heard something called Tea Board, there are some other institutions called Coffee Board. Like that, related to specific institutions, there are regulatory authorities. These are specific non-funding organization. Also, it's a regulatory organization. There are something common, not related to any specific industries as such. It is called the National Institute of Entrepreneurship and the Small Business Development. Then maybe if you might have heard that the Export Promotion Council, those are focused on export. It's not as such any specific industry. Then there is something called Investment Credit Guarantee Corporation of India. Somebody who make investment, their investment will be guaranteed by this set of organizations. Okay, this is the fair background in the classification of organizations which are facilitating a business in the those classification. There are two other small classification also, those organizations which is facilitating business. One is that auxiliary and aids to trade. There is some organization which is neither fall into this financial or non-financial or controlling or regulatory framework, but there are organizations which is supporting. For an example, there are a freight forwarder. You are operating in a production or a goods sector. Your goods need to be transported from one place to another place. That is called, they facilitate you also a business, okay? Unless that, otherwise you cannot, if you are not able to reach up to your customer, you will not be able to make your sale or your business go smooth. Therefore, those organizations also called a business facilitating organizations. One example I told, a freight forwarder. Another is a business incubator. There are some infrastructure provided by certain type of organizations which will help you to set up your business from the beginning to start running. Okay. And there are something called a financial consultant. You have some idea and you don't know how to make it in a structured manner. It's called, maybe they will help you with creating project plan and financial feasibility, feasibility report or government compliance report. Those things are also forms part of organization facilitating businesses. Okay, there are something, one more, there are a small set of classification category, it's called point of contact business facilitators. For an example, some of them are even regulators also, they do that, certain extent, many of the regulators which we initially discussed, they also form part of the same category. Maybe one such example I can tell you, which is a point of contact business facilitators, is like MSME sector. There is a nodal agency, which is a government agency, which helps whatever any small scale business or a person is trying to start up a business. They will guide you what are the process you need to be followed, how you can get the resources to start up your businesses, and how, which way you can get your funding if at all you are required. If you need some kind of training on the entrepreneurship or any specific industry or a product making, they will deliver those also. These are the another organizations called, it's a point of contact business facilitators. Now, I will come back once again, what we were discussing about business facilitating organizations. Majorly, there are two types, financial and non-financial. Even in non-financial, there are two additional classification. One is auxiliary and aid to trade. Another is point of contact for business facilitations. Hope you are able to understand that section. Okay. Yeah. We will move ahead in a little more details in a few of these organizations which we were talking about. One is we were talking about NABARD. Okay, NABARD is a National Bank for Agriculture and Rural Development, which is established in 1982. It is headquarters in Mumbai. You may be, it may be an irony if you start relating itself. I'm thinking that why it all set up in Mumbai, because it's a capital. It's a we are talking about the Agriculture and Rural Development Bank, and then it is set up in Mumbai. But it is for the operational convenience. The head office is set up in Mumbai, but the NABARD has a branch all over India. I'm sure some point in time when you travel across India, you might have noticed this NABARD board in many rural areas. It's like NABARD is an organization which directly funds many projects, like financing, say, construction of a road, construction of a school, something like that, common infrastructure facilitation, NABARD supports. As well as that, NABARD work as a nodal agency. Nodal agency, I mean, NABARD will be financing some organization in turn, which will also be refinancing to small organization. One such example is self-help groups. A lot of self-help groups are there now in microfinancing, which is doing microfinancing and supporting entrepreneurship. This NABARD supports those organizations. In turn, that organizations lend back to the next level of organizations. Even NABARD funds governments also. Say district administration or a state administration, if state government also they funds, and they fund means for a particular project that they will give the fund, but it is directly controlled, owned and maintained by the government. NABARD as such may not be doing the implementation of that project, rather they will do the funding and the feasibility study and project planning. Those things will be undertaken by NABARD. Okay, main now I told what they do in a layman sense, but technically there are some few objectives are given for NABARD. One is that development of cottage and small industry. We were talking about some example. Their the objectives are set in the charter of the NABARD. Is one is to development of cottage and small industries, and next is Apex. It works as an Apex finance agency. This is what I was telling. If a state government or some other nodal agencies need a finance, they will give the finance and will monitor the mechanism, how the project implementation is going on. And another is infrastructure and institution building, which I was telling, roads, dams, even schools, which will be built using the NABARD funding. Next is a project refinance, which also I told that okay, some projects are initially sponsored by somebody will be undertaking, but all those collectively, many projects put together will be forwarded to NABARD and they will be refinancing them. Training to another one task, one objective is to train to entrepreneurs. There are many entrepreneurs who may be having a business idea, but may not have the rest of the commercial knowledge to run that as a successful business. Therefore, NABARD helps them to do, run the business and learn the entrepreneurship in a formal way. Next, we will by this we will complete the NABARD. We will move on to some of the non financial organizations. One such organization which plays a lot of role in the economic development and progress of India is the Reserve Bank of India. Okay, I'm sure all of us heard Reserve Bank of India on some level or other. We are definitely aware of what is in Reserve Bank of India and what are the functions. But let us recap what are the important functions, objectives of Reserve Bank of India. Basic introduction about Reserve Bank of India is it is established in April 1935, but the act is passed in 34. Okay, the act is in 34 and established on 1935. Remember that. Sometimes it may a question come. It may be something like that. Your MCQ question also this is there. It will be a little tricky. You have to remember that when it is the act is passed on 1934 and established on 1935. Initially, it was a private organization kind of it was functioning. Later on, it is nationalized in the year of 1949 after the independence of India. And previously, it was started in Kolkata and moved to Mumbai. Now, the head office of Reserve Bank of India is in Mumbai. It is governed by board of directors, mostly appointed by the central government. Okay. Next, we will move on to the role of RBI. The main role of RBI is to strengthening, developing and diversifying the economic and financial structure. Okay. Once again, I will tell you, strengthening, developing and diversifying of the economic and the financial structure. We know that how the financial structure, we have a nationalized bank, private banks, there are Schedule 6 banks, cooperative banks and many, many banking structure are there. It is the primary responsibility of the RBI to govern, monitor, maintain all those financial institutions and financial system or structure of India. Next is stability and growth of economy. It is also an important for them to look. The objective is to stability and growth of the economy. It's not just about regulating or monitoring. Is also to ensure that the regulation and monitoring is facilitating growth and development of our economy. Controlling monetary policies, that is, maybe we will discuss a little more about monetary policy later point in time. But I have, as of now, please understand that RBI does the role of a monitoring, controlling and currency policies, economic policies. Is also RBI functions also as an advisor to central government on economic policies, representing India in international economic forums. Okay, whenever an economic forum or some other kind of representation comes, Reserve Bank of India represents India as a country. Guiding guides to commercial banks, which also we will cover a little bit details in the coming section. And marketing of government securities. This is the another function that you might have heard that in between Reserve Bank of India is selling some commercial papers, bonds, all those things is issued by central government. Okay, next is we so far discussed. See, all those three, four sections are there. Roles of RBI, functions of RBI, which all more or less look like the same. There are a lot of correlation. It's one and the same. It is presented in a slightly different fashion based on the circumstances. Other way around, more or less same, which is we were discussing as a role. Now the functions of RBI coming. One is the issue of currency. We all know that all currency notes are printed, issued, circulated, monitored, and controlled by Reserve Bank of India. Okay, except that coin. Coin is a central finance department is monitoring. Except that coins, all the currency notes are bearing the signature of Reserve Bank of India governor. also is issued and controlled, monitored based on the requirement of the society and India economy. They will be additionally printing. At times, they will take back and the currency and circulation will be curtailed to control. Even if you recall in 2016, the demonetization exercise is basically rolled out by Reserve Bank of India. Next is a banker to the government. Reserve Bank of India functions as the banker to the government of India. They are the custodian of all the government funds and books of accounts, and all those things are maintained by asset called gold or other reserves like forex reserve. Everything is maintained by Reserve Bank of India. That's why it's called banker to the government of India. Next is bankers bank. Reserve Bank also functions as the bankers bank. It's like all commercial banks, in case of they need additional fund, they will be approaching Reserve Bank of India. When they have an excess fund, it is also deposited with the Reserve Bank of India. There are many statutory other regulations. You might have heard that something called SLR, okay, statutory reserve, SRR, statutory reserve ratio, then CRR, capital reserve ratio. Those things are also specified, controlled by Reserve Bank of India. Next is, I was touching in between, is a custodian of foreign exchange reserves. As of now, the government of India is having a reserve of $555 billion. This whole $555 billion is under the custody of Reserve Bank of India. The other things which Reserve Bank of India doing taking care is a balance of payment and whatever IMF borrowable, anything is required. This is also monitored and controlled by Reserve Bank of India. And the controller of credit is also the credit growth. According to the broader policies and guidelines framed by the government of India, RBI is the agency which is rolling out all those things. Based on the government, they will increase priority of the economy. They will increase the interest rate, repo rate and reverse repo rate, which, through which mostly they control the credit and supply of money. And next is promotional functions. See, Reserve Bank also banking, especially in banking, they are the nodal agency for promoting the banking. What I mean is that, say you might have heard at some point in time that some conditions Reserve Bank put down that if at all, say for an example, ICICI Bank need to start 100 branches in 100 cities, then Reserve Bank also put a condition that you have to open at least 10 branches in the rural areas. Okay, then only will be given, you will be given an option to start a branches in the urban area. This is some kind of a promotion. Banking industry need to be promoted. It may not be commercially viable to run a branch, full-fledged branch in the rural areas many a times. But therefore, the business as such will be reluctant to do. But as a controller and maintenance of economic growth in India, Reserve Bank puts up these kind of restrictions to promote the banking industry. Another is a minimum balance criteria. You might have heard that if you want to maintain a saving account, you shall hold some minimum balance. That minimum balance is not standard all across all the branches. Urban, it may be 10,000. Rural, it will be 2,000 or 1,000. Semi-urban, it will be 2,000. Something like that, minimum amount. These are the certain things RBI does is to control the it is a promotional functions for the banking industry. Another such function RBI monitor does is that collection of public data. You might have heard that periodically Reserve Bank, Governor of Reserve Bank comes out and gave a press statement telling that the inflation, this previous quarter inflation or previous month, the retail inflation plus this, or WIP inflation was this 4.5%, 5.6%. Another is economic growth. Our GDP growth rate for the previous quarter was like 7.8%, 6.5%, something like that. These are also a lot of study. There is a research and development wing in RBI. they do that, and periodically based on their input, and they will prepare a papers and output based on that, these announcements will be done by the Reserve Bank of India. And another is roles in business facilitation. These all functions which we explained earlier helps in business one way or other. Say for an example, now if you look at that interest rate is coming down and again, it is to support business. Now the economy is not in that good shape. Therefore, many people are reluctant to invest in business. And the risk is very high. People feel that. Therefore, people would like to park the money in a bank account. To avoid that, government mostly reduces the interest rate and make this investing in bank deposits are not very attractive, pushing people to invest more on business or the people to buy shares or something like that, and which will in turn help the business, the entrepreneurs to continue with the business or start a new business, something like that. This is the way government, RBI facilitate in business organizations. Now, coming back to, we talk about another function which we told is the currency policy. Currency policy, which I was in between talking and telling that currency policy is like how much currency is required. What are the permutation and combination of a currency? Do we need a high value currency or a low value currency? Or what is the proportion of the high value currency or small currency? Which part of India requires more supply of currency? All those things are determined based on the study and other requirement actions by the different banking sector agencies inputs. These Reserve Bank.
Sir,
please.
Sir, the screen still shows the organization facilitating business.
Yeah. Okay. I did not separate. Yeah. Okay. Fine. Okay. This is the. Okay, we are here up to role in business facilitation is the place we are now. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Okay, and this is the currency policy we are discussing about. Now we will discuss about the credit policy. Credit policy also see the based on the Reserve Bank of India priority, they will decide that credit policy what should be the repo rate and reverse repo rate. Repo rate means the rate at which Reserve Bank of India gives loans to the scheduled banks. Okay. Reverse repo rate means the rate at which Reserve Bank of India accepts deposit from the commercial banks. Okay. These are the rate normally based on this. The difference between repo and reverse repo now is 1%. Previously, it was a different. Now it is a static. Now one is assigned, the other one will be automatically known to us, because this is the way when the banks are having excess fund, they can deposit with RBI and can get some fund, and vice versa, when they need more money to lend to the business or to the other needy customers, so they can take an overdraft kind of facility from the Reserve Bank of India. This is normally for 2 weeks period. Normally the deposit and the withdrawal is for 2 weeks period. After that, they need to settle or roll over to the next facility. Okay, and next is a development of financial system. I was talking about the banking. See, they determines that a new banking license need to be issued periodically. You might have seen that they have issued a few banking licenses last few years back, like Bandhan Bank. There are a few banks. Okay, all these banks are governed by the Reserve Bank of India. It's a development of financial system. Another is a fund transfer and payment mechanism. We are popularly using this NEFT, NEFT, RTGS, or e-payment. All these things are maintained and governed and supervised by Reserve Bank of India. This is also functions of a Reserve Bank of India. Maybe I can tell you about a couple of things along with this to the SLR and the statutory liquidity ratio and CRR. Okay, CRR ratio. Statutory liquidity ratio means you have a certain amount of asset and liabilities. You have certain amount of current liabilities. Then how much current assets you should hold to service those liability. It is called a SLR, statutory liquidity ratio. okay, credit reserve ratio is the other one. You are, when you are accepting a lot of deposits from customers, government expect you to create keep some certain amount of liquidity to Reserve Bank of India. Say in case of all the depositors coming and immediately asking for their money, and the bank should not fail. For that reason, some amount of money will be withheld by the Reserve Bank of India in case of emergency to withdraw. I'm not sure whether you people remember, and I think in the year of 2006-07 or some point in time, there was a lot of rumor that ICICI Bank is going to fail, and there are a lot of people are standing on the queue to withdraw the money. At that time, Reserve Bank of India released money from the CRR and also assured the customers that there is no problem with the ICICI Bank. Their financial position is stable and good. You did not worry about that. And they released the fund from the CRR, and therefore bank sailed through those tough time. Okay, for these purposes, Reserve Bank of India keeps a ratio, reserve ratio. One second. Okay, fine. Let us move ahead. The Sarat, Nisam?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
All fine? All fine?
Yes, sir.
Just we move ahead to next organization. Okay, it is a Security Exchange Board of India, SEBI, popularly known as SEBI, Security Exchange Board of India. And it is established 12th April 1988. Okay, this is an organization which controls the issue of shares, stock exchanges, all those activities which is happening in India. It is brought through the act in the parliament in the year of 1992. Even though it is established 1988, statutory powers are given through 1992. 30th January through an act in the parliament. It is, the main objective is to authority to develop and regulate capital market. It is to control and regulate the capital market. The head office is in Mumbai. Previously, before that, there is something called CCI. Okay, it's not Competition Commission of India. It's not that. It's a controller of capital issues. Was the previous body taking care of this one before SEBI. And that organization is abolished and brought the new law, and no organization called SEBI has established. It's a governed by a chairman, which is appointed by central government. What are the major functions of SEBI? The major functions of the SEBI are to protect the interest of investors. Okay, say for an example, now I as an investor want to purchase some shares. What protection I have? I purchased the shares and the business person swindled entire money. And then we will be left with no money, as well as our investors' trust will go off. Therefore, this is the primary responsibility of SEBI to protect the interest of the investors. Next is regulate, protect, and promote security market. Equally, it is okay.
Hello? Hello, what happened, sir?
Nizam Sarath, Santosh will be joining in a while. Actually, his laptop got restarted. Just give us a minute, okay?
Hello.
Santosh, you are co-host. You can again share the screen.
Okay. Okay. Able to hear?
It's visible.
Yeah.
Nizam, Sarat, can you confirm?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Sorry for the interruption. I think my machine got restarted. Don't know why, but suddenly got to start. Okay, we'll continue with SEBI. Okay, we were discussing about the functions of Security Exchange Board of India to regulate, protect, and promote the security market. Okay, that if you monitor, you might have heard that. Okay, maybe in the past, Infosys come with a listing of shares. Or new companies coming recently, maybe IRCTC come with a public issue, and many other new companies coming with a issue of shares. These or all organizations need to take permission from SEBI and file the details with them. And book building, it's called book building process. All those processes need to be followed. Okay. One second, there is some problem in my. Give me 1 minute. I will connect another laptop. Okay. 1 second.
Okay, sir.
Hello. Hello. Yeah. Sharad.
Hello, sir.
You are able to hear me, no?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Okay, I will quit from there. You may not be able to see the presentation, but I think you'll be fine, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Maybe I'll send a presentation to you, or we'll see that once. Otherwise the echo will come. If both are there, you'll not be able to hear properly.
Yeah.
Just 2 minutes, I will. Second, I'll just forward that presentation also to this machine.
Let me share my screen. I think, who is admin? Can you set me as an admin? Is admin now? Okay. Seeing properly why it is so less. Okay. Okay, sorry for all the troubles. Fine. Are you able to see my screen?
Yeah, yeah. Yes, we are able to see it.
Okay. We'll move ahead. Okay. We were discussing about schedule. Okay, this is an organization which controls and regulates the stock market, the security issue. I was talking about any public issue comes, and the book building process and other intermediary process all need to take their approval from the SEBI, Security Exchange Board of India. And maybe CARVI, some other organization you might have heard in between, those are the intermediaries who is helping those companies who are issuing shares in their public listing of shares. Okay, next is it's a quasi legislative body. What is mean by quasi? Means semi. Quasi means semi legislation. They have certain powers to bring out a new legislation. Normally legislation is the area where parliament or assembly, constituent assemblies at state level and central government, the parliament at the India level, it's bringing. But this is an organization, it's a quasi legislative. They can bring a law related to that area, governance or and the security market in India. For that related certain laws, they have the power to bring or certain modifications to the current law. They have that authority. That is called, it's a quasi legislative. It's called quasi judicial also, because they also have a certain power to adjudication. See, normally, if you have a judicial system, we have a district and courts, then it will go to high court, then it will go to Supreme Court. This is having certain powers. Therefore, this will also work as the first level of a judicial system. After that, it will go to security appellate authority. For an appeal, which is equal to high courts in the states, and then directly the appeal from the appellate tribunal will go to Supreme Court. Okay. Normally, in any other cases, normally the first level of appellate is gone over that. Say, for an example, income tax means some other cases are there, and then from the income tax tribunal will go to the respective high court. From the high court, it will go to Supreme Court. In case of Security Exchange of Board of India, if any adjudication which has happened in appellate authority level, tribunal level, if it is not satisfactory, the review directly will go to Supreme Court, not to any high courts. Okay, then it's a quasi executive judicial at all, in the executive also. It is a they have the executive powers of a normal administration system. They can give direction to the companies to follow certain regulations. All those things are executive powers. When a law is set by the government of India or the state government, it is through the IAS, IPS executive network it is implemented. Similar way, SEBI also has an infrastructure of a certain level of employees and powers and regulations. They can direct the business organizations or the other related organization to follow the rules and regulations using their executive powers. Next is the function I was talking about. It also work as an appeal in Security Appellate Tribunal. Okay, this is also from the it also have a tribunal set under it. It also works as an appeal against the primary if there is any dispute between either SEBI or the different business organizations related to the listing or anything related to security market, then they can approach this appellate tribunal, which is also monitored and controlled by SEBI. Second appeal, directly I told it will be in Supreme Court. Okay. Next is powers of SEBI. What are the powers of SEBI is having? According to the law, Government of India passed in 1988, what are the powers given in the SEBI Act? One is that approve bylaws of stock exchanges. When a new stock exchange is starting, they need to be submitted to SEBI for review approval. Based on that approval of SEBI only, any stock exchange in India can function. Say for Bombay Stock Exchange, National Stock Exchange, which are all already existing before SEBI. But if any modification they are bringing into their bylaws, it needs to be approved by SEBI. Next is amendment to stock exchange bylaws. That's what I was covering. Approval for the new stock exchange and changes to the existing stock exchange. Inspect the books of accounts of stock exchange. Stock exchange is a placeholder of many people's wealth, amount, share, as well as the money which they are doing the selling, buying, all those settlement happening to them. Therefore, SEBI has the power to verify their books of accounts. Also, inspect the financial intermediaries. I was talking about normally Carby and many other ICICI bank or many other people are worked as an underwriters or helping on the listing of shares. These are organizations called the intermediaries. SEBI has the power to verify the books of accounts of them also. Okay. And one more very important function, which may be rarely heard, that SEBI can ask some company which are not listed or to list in stock market. If the SEBI feels that these are very, very sensitive and which organization have a lot of public interest, which is continuing as a private sector, may not be good for the essence of the capital security market of India, then they may insist upon certain cases to function it as a public company rather than private. Recently, there was some issue going on. Yeah, I think still not settled, which is there in case of Tata Sons. In case of, you know, in the mystery episode, you might have noticed, I'm not sure. But there are something. Tata Sons is a holding company of TCS, Tata Motors, and many other public listed companies. Okay, the major public listed companies are owned by Tata Sons, which is a private limited company. Okay, there is a conflict coming in where a private limited company can hold like such a big public limited company. For that, there are cases going on, and one time SEBI told that it should be de facto public limited company, even though it is a private limited company. Okay, these are the certain examples I would like to tell you regarding when what is the power of SEBI with regards to monitoring and controlling, governing of securities market, security market in India. role another in a role in business facilitation, which is all, you know, helping issue book building process sharing, and also the it facilitates a policy which allows small organizations, medium or very small organizations, to come into capital market and try to find a fund. I may not be telling very small organizations, but reasonably coming, we are talking about Infosys, TCS and all. Then there are very, very, very small organizations also. SEBI offers a level playing field for these small organizations also to list their shares in the primary market and trade in the secondary market. These all are the facilitation done by SEBI to the smooth conduct of business and security market in India. Okay. You have any doubt, anything of the sections so far taken? If you have anything, you can ask me. Not an issue at all. Okay. Nisham? Sarath? Hearing?
Yes, sir.
You are not able to see me? Or okay, fine. You are able to hear now? You are able to follow me, right?
Yeah. Okay.
If you have any doubt, you can ask me. Not an issue. Any time you can stop and ask me. Okay?
Okay.
Other way around, how things are going? Your studies are all good? Going fine?
No. Yes, sir. Sir, we are appearing in May only.
Okay. You are appearing in May only, not in hurry in the
December.
Then it's not there actually. Okay, you have enough time. Okay, fine. But keep this as a base and then you can start from here. Okay?
Yeah.
Okay. And we will move ahead with the Competition Commission of India. Another organization which facilitates business in India is the Competition Commission of India. And the basic details about this, it is to ensure that fair competition in the country. Okay, in the economy and country, there should be a fair competition. Okay, fair means it should not be too much competition. It should not be no competition also. It's something like that. Fair. It should have an equal treatment to whomever and the players in the same field should have an opportunity to sell their products or buy their products, whatever be that case. Okay, that is called a level playing field. It's like there can be a big organization selling some product. There can be same products sold by small organization. The big organization should not suppress the small organization, which will not be able to function in the market. Therefore, Competition Commission of India ensures that a level playing field is offered to big and small or different kind of organizations. And the primary function, another one important function of Competition Commission of India is to welfare of the customers. Since the consumer is the consumer should benefit all those things. Competition is for to benefit the consumers, not only the other traders. It's also focusing the mind of consumers. It is also to promote direct and indirect competition. Okay. And benefits of a fair, what are the benefits? Then there are, why we are talking about there should be a fair competition. Then there are certain benefits for fair competition. That is the reason they were stressing on the point that there should be a fair competition. One is that it will help in doing innovation, because something is happening regularly and new entrepreneurs will come and start thinking that I have to do it in a differently, then I will be able to get a more market share. But then therefore it will facilitate innovation. Next is it will promote efficiency. If you have free market there without any competition, whatever price you are telling, they are willing to take it, then there is no efficiency in the system. You will not be able to compete with international market. Okay, therefore it will also bring efficiency. Punish the laggards, whomever doing mischievous thing in the market, they will be punished. Also, if you are is not able to do according to the scale of economy, if you are not able to cost effectively produce, you will be out of the market since competition is there. If competition is not allowed, it will be difficult. Say for an example, if you see Middle East, here there are not much competition in many cases. See, the sole dealership concept is there in the Middle East for many products, many automobile dealership, whether it's a mobile dealership, all those things. Here only one single agency is there. There is no competition. If Samsung sells that, we are selling at only at this price in this country, we don't have much option other than to buy. But which is not a case in India, because Competition Commission of India and other related organizations ensures that every people, entrepreneurs or a different business have a fair chance of bringing their product and selling without this restriction. Okay. Before this, it's called MRTP. It's a Monopoly and Restrictive Trade Practices Act, which was the act before CCI was prevalent in India. Later, that act is abolished and a new act brought is Competition Commission of India. It is more fairer. Previously, it was just an act which was mostly controlled by the government of India. But now this has a commission. It's a commission, has a commission, and it's an organization itself has a lot of powers and things to do things of their own. And features and roles. That is what we are talking about. This is established in 2002. No, the act is passed in 2002 and it is established in 2003. Okay, it's to prevent adverse effect of competition. Okay, this is one of that adverse effect of competition. If too much competition is there, you have an adverse effect on the economy, because all other small and other players will get eliminated from the market. After that, there will be free will of certain limited entities, organizations or persons to do whatever they want in certain industries. Therefore, it is to ensure that adverse impact of competition in case of consumers also. Adverse impact of competition means if when there is a competition is not there, then the price for the consumer will be high. They can sell at whatever they want. Therefore, all respect, it is the duty of the Competition Commission of India to ensure that adverse impact of competition is not there in the economy. Protect the consumer interest, freedom of trade. I was talking that if somebody want to somebody produce an item which is a quality one, we shall facilitate him to trade in India, but whichever market he want, which some private players or others should not stop them doing their trade. That's called freedom of trade. Okay. Role in business facilitation, which I was talking about, it will help them to fair practice, fair option given to everybody. Consumers will get the prices cheaper comparatively if there is no competition exists. And all small players will get a level playing field to sell their product also. Okay. By this, I will complete Competition Commission of India. And the next another important organization is Insurance Regulatory and Development Authority.
Sir, there is competition some acts in India, no?
Competition?
There is some competition.
That is CCI. Competition Act is the act which brought this Competition Commission of India, CCI.
Yeah.
Okay, this act, it is the act name, it is Competition Act. But the commission and it is brought, it is called Competition Commission of India.
In India, we have some free trade, no? Suppose if one company is establishing and suppose it causing some disturbance or some existence problem to other small enterprises, how come that this Competition Commission can help those small businesses?
Okay, see how this plays normally is that, say, for an example, you are, as a big organization, produce some item with a cost of 90 rupees and you sell normally at 100 rupees.
Yeah.
Okay, now you understood that there are two other three players also, which is in the market, very small people. They produce at a cost of 95 and they sell at 100. Because you are selling at 100, they cannot also sell more than that, but they produce at 95, they sell at 100. Okay, this big person suddenly drops his margin and starts selling at 91, because which is his cost is 90 and he sells at 91. He's telling, I don't need profit. But then what will happen? Effectively, the small organization which the cost of product is 95, they will not be able to sell in the market.
Yeah.
Then these cases, the small organization can approach to the CCI and tell that, say, this is the normal industry cost of production, and the our competitor is selling at 91, which is, will make us too irrelevant in the market. We will be out of the field. Then,
case, sir, in India, will... sir, in India, we have freedom to fix the prices, no?
You see, you have a freedom to fix the prices with certain limitations only. Okay. If any normal consumer product, you always have that freedom. But in case of industrial products and many other products, which is, say, for example, customer a choice is required, where because of your pricing, the customer choices is getting denied, then Competition Commission of India can interfere into and look into it. The example which I am telling, okay, say for an example, he given a complaint to the Competition Commission of India, the trader, then the Competition Commission review, and they will understand that previously he was selling at 100, suddenly he dropped the price to 91 only to ensure that these players would go out of the market. Then the Competition Commission will insist that your price should not be more than 90, should not be less than 100 or 99 or something like that. That is the one thing. Okay. The other way around also will happen. Okay. Say for an example, there were no competition. Then the person who is producing at 90 start selling suddenly at 150. Okay. Then that case also, they can approach Competition Commission, consumers or whomever, telling that he is charging absorbently high profit, and because of this, there is no competition. In this case also, Competition Commission of India have the power to restrict to the selling price. Even though our market is free and there is no restriction on price setting. That is largely true in case of a very voluminous product. There are multiple producers and multiple sellers. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Then there are limited players and sellers. This kind of restriction is possible, and they have the powers to do that. Okay. Shall we move ahead to insurance regulatory authority of India, or you have some other doubts?
No.
Okay. And we will move ahead to Insurance Regulatory and Development Authority of India. It's called IRDAI, and it is also an autonomous apex institution passed in Parliament, and based on the Parliament, it's also a statutory body. It is coming to existence in 1999. There was some organization before that also. There were a lot of changes that come, and this Insurance Regulatory Authority of India was brought in 1999. Okay, main purpose of this is to protect the policyholders' rights and registration of insurance companies. There are many insurance companies, and registration of them and maintenance of those companies is also part of the important functions of an insurance regulatory authority of India. Okay,
sir, these institutions are statutory, no? Means they have that autonomous in power, right?
Correct.
But why the central government is appointing the, for example, in case of RBI, why they are appointing the, governor and all?
See, the appointment is, all those independent organizations also, it is appointed by government of India only. Okay, see, autonomous doesn't mean that they can do whatever they want. See, once you are appointed as a Reserve Bank of governor, Government of India will not tell that what you need to do. Okay, autonomous means that is what is. It's not a full autonomous organization for every respect. Even for the case of, say for an example, now we are talking about our judicial system, High Court and Supreme Court, it is autonomous. We are talking about judiciary assets. Still, there are certain amount of controls in central government. You see this collegium will recommend the judges' names, and it will go to CVC to verify. Central Vigilance Commission will verify those names, and either central government may approve or disapprove. Okay, something like that process only. It's not, see, autonomous doesn't mean that it's an absolutely a free organization like whatever they want to run. Rather, there are certain guidelines. Within the guidelines, they have the freedom to work. If you could understand better, I will tell you that. There are autonomous universities, you heard.
Yeah.
Okay. Universities, now a lot of autonomous universities are there. See, they are not a full-fledged universities as such. They don't have every power of the university. But they are given certain amount of freedom, like they can decide their syllabus. they can decide upon the valuation and examination schedule, and they can decide upon the pass percentage, all passing mark, and how much should be internal mark, what should be the external mark. All those are their freedom. May not necessarily how many years should be a course. All those things will not be part of their decision making. Like that, there is a framework is given. Within that framework of law allowed, what can be done. In this all the institution which we are talking about act, that governance model is that central government, mostly the finance department, controls them, the appointment of the representatives. Once they are appointed, central government is not going to interfere into the day-to-day matters, should not be interfering into the day-to-day matters of the organization.
Yeah.
Am I clear? Sir.
Yes, yes.
Okay. Now, the mission. What are the missions of IRDAI? Insurance Regulatory and Development Authority of India, what are the their mission? Fair treatment to policyholders. Say, for an example, an insurance policy is issuing. For me, say 10 lakh rupees coverage, maybe 10,000. For you, it's 10 lakh rupees coverage, 8,000 rupees, which should not be there. Okay? For a same amount of risk and all those things, it should be same amount. That's called fair treatment to policyholders. All the policyholders should be treated fairly. Speedy and orderly growth to the insurance sector. They also need to ensure that the whatever policies they are bringing into the helps in growing the insurance sector in India. Okay. And promote and monitor high standard of integrity. Another issue is that integrity should be there. A lot of fund is there, money related. There should be an integrity that you are taking a policy and certain amount of risk coverage is accepted. Then if the risk is matured, if the incident is happened, then your commitment should be honored and with integrity. Okay. Don't find out some loopholes like that and will not be honored. Like that's a fair treatment should be done, should be avoided this kind of discrimination. Next is ensuring speedy settlement of claims. That's what. Another thing is that, okay, now you have insured for something. Some incident happened, then claim should be processed in a reasonable period of time, which will help, say, for a business. A building is insured, there was a fire damage, and you are accepted the claim, but which you are not paying in 5 years' time. Then the whole business is lost and he is not able to run it. Rather, it should be processed in a maybe 3 months to 6 months' time, in a reasonable point in time, he can bring his business in back. Okay? Next is a self-regulate the industry. Another is that this is having to regulate the industry. There are many insurance companies in India, and the different kind of insurance services are offered and with the different pricing models. All those things need to take the approval of IRDAI. They have the power to monitor and regulate this kind of framework. Next is duties, powers, and functions. Registration of insurance companies. I was talking about there are many insurance companies. All the insurance companies operating in India need to be registered with IRDAI. Then the protects the interest of the policy holders. The IRDAI has the power to assure the say, for an example, I took a insurance and maybe a 20 years term or something. When 20 years is over, insurance company is not paying to me, or in absence of me, the dependents of me is not paying. Then we can approach to IRDA and ensure that it is insurance companies following the guidelines and safeguarding the interest of the policyholder. Next is a code of conduct for insurance players. There are a lot of code of conducts about insurance company, what needs to be done, how they need to maintain their books of accounts, what are the other instruction laws and regulations need to be followed by the insurance companies. These also can be monitored and regulated by the IRDAI. Efficiency in operations. Also, they can also see a certain amount. If you put a lot of restrictions, industry and insurance company may not be able to function properly. Therefore, they should also review periodically that the international best practices is coming in. If at all those practices install in India, whether it will be beneficial and speedy resolution. Say, for an example, previously, if an accident happens, we need to do every claim, take a physical paper, write everything and submit to the insurance company, then they will send an assessor, they will come and evaluate all those things. Today, this claim can be online. These are the changes, what is happening in the industry, it's also adapting. It's also responsibility of the IRDA to take care of these things and make a reasonable initiative to ensure that these things are functioning in a proper manner, in a speedy manner. Next is levying fees and charges. If you have noticed that some of the insurance, there will be additional levy or stamp duty, all those things. Stamp duty previously, sometimes it will not be there, but nowadays, see, all the policies issuing in India bearing a revenue stamp, then that means it's a levy. They can, IRDA can insist upon that how much amount of levy need to be put on that each and every policy. Another is a regulating the funds and insurance companies. Say for an example, every year insurance company is collecting premium from people. Say for an example, this year doesn't have any accident, but that doesn't mean that they can take that entire money. Okay, then this IRDA will stipulate that, okay, this much amount should be transferred to reserve and it be kept as a risk reserve. After that only balance, only if any profit is there, only can be shared among the shareholders. Or not that in policy holders money directly you can take it as and use it for your business purposes. Okay, and dispute resolution. If at all any dispute comes between insurance companies or a policy holder and a policy issuer, this also can be regulated and monitored, and the resolution can be offered by IRDA. And another thing is that, say for example, motor insurance policy and all, you always hear that insurance premium is increased. Once a player is increased, everybody is increasing, because the player is not increasing. Other than IRDA is telling that a third party insurance policy risk premium is increased. This kind of premium controlled areas, the power is given to IRDA to fix that. This also helps in business facilitation. I'm sure you understand that. How this will help in business in thing. Say for an example, an
premium is the fees paid, no?
Yeah, premium is the fees paid. Yeah, premium is a fees paid by the insured to the insurance company to cover that certain risk mentioned in the policy.
Sir, in the equity shares also is there, no? Securities premium and all, that is different, no?
That is totally different. That security premium is called, say for an example, I am a running organization. I am fixing that share value is 10 rupees. Okay.
Yeah.
At the time of issuing, it's one share holding 10 rupees. Now I was working, the company was running good and making profit. Now also I cannot give one share for 10 rupees because I invested a lot of money and my business is running well. I need a premium. At that time, if at all I am issuing that shares new to the new people, then I will tell that I need a premium. That is called share premium. Instead of 10 previously, I may be now giving for 20 or a 30. Yeah. Now there are market, if you observe, there are 10 rupees share is issuing at 1,200. That means 1,100 is a premium, share premium.
Yeah.
Okay?
Okay, sir.
Okay. This is called insurance premium. That is a share premium. By this, concluding this informal organizations, non-financial organizations supporting the business, that is organization facilitating business section, I am finishing. And here and after, we will move to common business terminologies. If you have any question related to any of this section, we can have a small chat. After that, we'll continue the new section. Or if you are fine with that, we'll move ahead. Okay. And we will move ahead and see common business terminologies. There are plenty of terminologies given in your books. And I have only selected a few based on whatever be the not that common. Also, it's an important for you, looks like. Other than that, anything else you have went through that material, if you have any doubt, you can ask. We can discuss, not a issue. A few are I listed. Those we will discuss in summary here. Okay. One is that amortize. What is mean by amortize? Amortize means there are certain expenses we incurred the business. Normally, whenever preparing a profit and loss account, all the expenses item will be charged into profit and loss account, and all the asset and liabilities will be placed in the balance sheet. In case of amortization, there are certain expenses incurred, but will not be charged to profit and loss account directly, rather than be thinking that some economic benefit of that expenses will be yielding in multiple years time, then we will tell that we will amortize those expenses and return off gradually. It may be written off in 3 years period, or maybe a 5 years period, maybe a 10 years period, based on a certain expenses. If I tell some example, and if you are planning to build a building, and initially you are saying that project to a plan, study of that given, or a feasibility project is given. There were certain expenses incurred for doing that feasibility study of that particular building. And later you decided to construct the building, you constructed the building. At that time, you can amortize this expense also part of the building and rent off along with the building. Okay, this is the one example for amortization. Or one more example, if I can tell, is that, say, for an example, when a company is incorporating, starting, at the beginning, you will have a lot of expenses. It's like consulting with a finance consultant, doing a lot of registration charges to government and bodies. All those cannot be written off as a 1 year expense, because once you are registered, that company is going to exist forever. There is no need to do the registration charges again. Therefore, the economic benefit of your expenses is not limited to one financial year. Therefore, you capitalize those expenses and write off gradually. Okay. This is called amortization.
Sir, we have amortization of goodwill, no?
Yeah, you amortization of goodwill also there. When you purchase a goodwill from another business, if you acquire a business, and that there is a company, there is an element of goodwill, then those goodwill will be amortized and kept in your books of accounts. It's called amortization of goodwill.
Yeah.
That is also, we are expecting that the financial benefit will be derived in the multiple years. Therefore, it is capitalized.
Okay,
sir. Okay. Next is appreciation. Appreciation means the value of an asset is going up rather than the current day. It's called appreciation. So, for an example, your company holds a fixed asset like a building or a land. And the next year, the value of a building goes up. Then it's called appreciation. Okay. And we'll move to next one. Arbitrage. Arbitrage means an opportunity exists for the same product and item. If you buy in one market and sell in another market without doing any changes, you will get some profit. If a price difference is there, then it is called arbitrage. Okay. Normally, arbitrage will, over a period of time, arbitrage will be zero or negligible. There can be a short-term market difference. Say, for an example, onion, when the prices of onion goes up, say, for an example, Nasik market is a producing area where the price will be lesser, and you just buy onion from there, and you come and sell it to the another buyer in, say, for in New Delhi or somewhere, and there will be a profit. This is called an arbitrage. You are not doing anything else. Also, you are not selling to the end consumers, or you are only in the buying and selling in the middleman, as a middleman, because there is a premium exists. You are not a normal trader, nor you are not a normal business person who is trading in onion, but you find an opportunity to buy at a lower price and sell at a higher price. Then this existence of this particular concept, that the price difference is called arbitrage. Okay. And next is intangible assets. We were talking about goodwill. Tangible assets are intangible. Intangible asset is an asset which you cannot see using your eyes. Normally, all the fixed assets or assets are seeable and touchable. And intangible assets are which you cannot see, but it holds a value. Goodwill is an example. Royalty is another example. Say, for an example, if you are out to use something from somebody else, you need to pay a certain amount to another person. It is called a royalty. Okay. Next is a ask or offer. Say for an example, I am willing to sell something and I am asking for a specific rate, that minimum rate which you are looking for. That is called ask price or offer price, or ask or offer. In audit. Audit means careful review of financial records for its accuracy. This is what is a simple definition of an audit. Careful verification of books of accounts of company for its accuracy. It's called audit. Next is a bad debts. Bad debts means you are doing a business. You are given certain credit to your customers, and your customer is not paying in time, or not willing to pay, or not in a position to pay you. Then that debtor's balance is called bad debts. Then next is a book value. Book value means value of your assets minus value of your liabilities is called book value. Next is a maybe break-even point. Break-even point is a point where your revenue equal to your expenses for any given period. Your revenue from the sales operations is equal to your expenses for the business operation. Then that amount is called break-even point. Next is a bear market and a bull market. Bear market means the price of a share is coming down regularly, then it's called a bear market. Bull market means price of any shares is going up continuously, then it's called a bull market. Blue chip. Blue chip means good shares, which irrespective of the market conditions, it makes continuously profit, reasonable profit. It makes consistently in the past many years, they are making profit and increasing the wealth of the shareholders. Then those kind of shares are called blue chips. Beta,
sir,
means,
can you just once more tell me what is blue chips?
Yeah, blue chip means it's also a stock of certain companies. Okay, blue chip means also a shares only. It's also shares of those companies whose performance is good over a period of time, even now also. That means, say for example, if you tell Reliance as a company, is a big company. Last many years, it is consistently giving profit to the shareholders. Also, the value of the shareholders' wealth is increasing. Those kind of shares where shareholders can certainly believe, or probably more believe that you invest in those shares, you may not end up in loss. You will getting reasonable profit at least. Those kind of companies are called, or those company shares are called blue chips.
Okay.
And okay. Beta is a performance index of any company, performance measuring against the performance of the index. Say for an example, now that we are talking about BSE Sensex is at 39,500, and last year it's given a 5% return, and this Reliance is given 50% return. Then that the different assessment, this difference is called beta. Okay, that beta performance. Okay, now we will call something call and put option. Call option or put option. You may be heard this term, I'm not sure. Okay, you have heard what is that? There is something called in the trading, in the share trading or a security trading, there is an option called you can buy a share immediately. Say for an example, TCS sharing share is selling at 2000. You are telling that 10 shares I will buy for 10,000 each is 20,000. I will pay 20,000. I will get 10 TCS shares. Also, there is another concept called, okay, now the price of a Infosys share is at 1200. I will buy 31st December 10 shares of Infosys at 1250 rupees. Okay. That means 12,500 rupees for 10 shares of Infosys. I will pay. Okay, I will pay. Are you able to hear, Nisham?
Yeah, yeah.
Sarath, fine. Are you able to hear? Sarath is on. Sarath also hopefully there. No?
Yes, sir.
Okay. And what is call and put option? I was telling that all the relative terms, then you will be able to remember it better. Okay. The first I told that is a spot rate. What I told initially is that you have some money and you are buying TCS share at 2000 rupees. Immediately 10 shares for 20,000. 10 shares of TCS. This is called a immediate trade or a spot trade. You are having a money, you are giving that and getting the share. The second one I am telling is Infosys share at 1200 is the current market price, but you are not buying it. You are telling that I will buy 31st December Infosys share at 1250. It is called forward contract. Normally it's called forward contract, and you will be buying on that day by paying 1250 rupees the value for the Infosys share. On that day, 31st December, Infosys shares may be 1300. Still, you will be able to get it 1250. It may be 1000. The Infosys share value may be at 1000, but you will be forced to buy at 1250. Because you are sure that you will buy on 31st December. Equally, there will be somebody else might have been sold these shares at that price. On that day, I will give you Infosys share at that price. Okay. And what is that is forward contract. First I told spot or immediate trade, and now I told it's a forward trade. Now I am going to tell call option or a put option. There is a concept called an option trading. Say for an example, I am telling the current example which I told Infosys shares. I am telling that 31st December I will buy at 1250. Okay, I took that contract buying 10 shares of Infosys at 31st December at 1250. But the share price of Infosys on 31st December, it is 1100. If I have 1100, I can buy a new shares, but I have to buy this old agreed shares at 1250. Then I have an option. If I am buying an option, I can have an option to tell that I don't want it. Okay, that is that I am not buying it. Say for an example, the Infosys share price on 31st December was 1350. Actually, I will be making a 100 rupees profit per share. Then I will buy it. This option of buying or selling based on your choice, it is called option trading. Okay, call option means I have an option to buy. Put option means I have an option to sell. Okay? You got it?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Shall we move ahead?
Yes, yes.
Okay. Next is a business risk. What is business risk? An inherited risk to do a business. Say for an example, if you invest your price, if you have some money, if you invest in a commercial bank, you will get a 5% interest or a 7% interest. Then there is an inherent small risk, which if a bank goes bankrupt, you will not be getting that money. That is called your investment risk. When you do a business, you equally have a risk of not getting your investment back, or you are expecting a return is not able to get it back. That risk element is called business risk. Okay, different type of business, it will be different rate of risk. There is a measurement of risk and all those things, industry to industry, there are many other concepts related to it. But as a initial basic, you have an understanding that carrying out a business activities, there is certain amount of risk exists. It is called business risk. Okay. Next is a credit period. You might have heard that, okay, if you buy an item from a shop, you will get a credit option. Say pay after 30 days or a pay after 90 days. This amount of credit period means amount of time you are getting to repay the consideration of the item you purchase, that is called credit period. And the next one is a convertible securities. Convertible securities means the securities which you are buying in a one form. After some point in time, you have an option to convert the different type of security. Say for an example, you might have heard that there is something called there are different type of securities. You might have heard that there is something called a share, debentures, bonds, like that. Okay, then in there are shares also. You might have heard that there are equity shares, there are preference shares, all those things. Okay, yes, security, these all are securities. Okay, all are common term is a securities. Share, preference share, equity shares, all that. So for an example, I am a holder of a preference share. Preference share means a share which is entitled to get a specified amount of dividend in a specified period of time. But I don't have it's not an equity shares. Any preference share need to be repaid over a certain period of time after the life. Say for an example, I am issuing a company, I am holding a company. My company is issuing a share for 5 years period. 5 years, I will pay this dividend of 10% or 12% each. And end of the fifth year, I will repay the entire money of that the shares and get it back and settled. There is a concept called if I am a shareholder, I can have the option to convert this as a equity shares. Instead of getting the final money back, after 5 years of getting dividend, I can tell that, okay, now I will convert this into an equity shares. I'll get the actual representation in the company. This kind of shares, which is having that option to convert, it is called convertible securities. This can be a preference share, can be a debenture also. Some companies issue a debenture of 1 lakh rupees. Okay, after 10 years of debenture's life of 7% interest, 10 years after that debenture holder has an option to convert that into an equity shares. This is called convertible securities. Next is a consolidation. Consolidation means a grouping of or merging of two different entities to put together to form a new business entity is called a consolidation. Okay, that's a business consolidation. Then there is a concept called financial statement consolidation also. You have two or three business entities in a group, and they are preparing different financial statements and put together, they consolidate as a group, which is called a financial statement consolidation. Okay, say for an example, now we were talking about Tata Sons. Tata Sons is a private limited company. It holds shares of TCS, Tata Motors, Tata Steel, Tata Elxsi, like many companies. At the level of a Tata Sons, there will be a balance sheet, financial statement will be prepared. That is a consolidated balance sheet. Okay, here mostly consolidation means two or three business organizations coming together to form a different business is called also a consolidation. Derivatives. Derivatives means price of a security is derived from the underlying value of an asset. Okay, there are derivative means it's also a security, but that the price of that security will be decided based on the value of an underlying asset. So for an example, now we are heard about a mutual funds. Certain people are buying certain amount, 50,000 mutual fund value. Then they will tell that it's based on NAV. NAV means net asset value. Say for an example, the fund manager got 10 lakh rupees. He purchased 10 lakh worth of shares, invested, and after 1 year, it become 11 lakhs. That means now the value of a derivative, previously that particular item was at 10, if there were 10 lakh and if there will be 1 lakh number of units, then it should have been 10. Now it is 11 lakh, the value will become 11. That means that mutual fund is a derivative. That mutual fund unit is a derivative because the value of that particular derivative is derived based on the share holding. What are the shares held by that fund manager? Okay. And next one is a diversification. Diversification means you are doing some kind of business. Now you feel that, okay, that business alone is doing may not be good enough. And let me do another business also. Say for an example, somebody is doing a textile retail. He started another retail of a stationery item. Then it is called diversification. He diversified his business from textile retail to stationery retail also. Holding period. There is a period called holding. Say for an example, somebody is investing in shares of a buying. Somebody is buying, undertaking another business. Say for an example, Infosys buying a shares of a certain company, and it is, there will be a definite the limitation or restrictions to putting that this company should hold minimum this point of a period of time that particular shares. That is called holding period. Okay, I mean some certain amount of investment, whatever it can be, not necessarily shares. Even if we are buying a debenture or a bond, then it telling that it's a value period is a 5 years. Then that period of 5 years you are holding that instrument with you is called a holding period. Okay. Next is a initial public offer. Initial public offer means a company for the first time their shares are going to list in the capital market and get money from the people. This is called the initial public offer. Any company listing first time, it will be through initial public offer. Subsequently also they use us that word, and second time, third time issue also, it's called initial public offer only. But basically this concept is that any company which is previously a private limited company issuing the shares for the first time to the public and getting that money, that process is called initial public offer. Market capitalization. Market capitalization means the total share value of that company. Say for an example, Infosys is having 10 lakh shares of 1000 each. That 10 lakh is the number of total paid up capital shares of Infosys, and share market value is 1000. Then 10 lakh into 1000, that is the total market value of Infosys. This is this kind of calculation. Share price into total number of shares is called market capitalization. Mutual fund. I told in between I was explaining. Mutual fund means this investment, investment in securities, debentures, bonds, or shares by a fund manager after collecting money from a different unit holders, and divided. The units are divided and given to the unit holders. This concept of pooling of resources and buying securities of companies is called mutual fund. Next is a return on investment. Return on investment means, say for an example, when I am starting a business, I invested 10 lakh rupees. After end of the year, I got 1 lakh as a profit. Then what is my return of investment is 1 lakh divided by 10 lakh into 100, that is 10%. That is my return of investment is 10%. This is the way return of investment is computed. Okay. Not moving. Okay, it's not in percentage. Okay, next. This is a market and capital related terminologies. Now, this marketing terminologies. There are equally many marketing related terminologies, and a few of the marketing technology terminologies also we will discuss. Barrier to trade. One concept is called barrier to trade. That means there are certain barriers to make certain trades. Okay, and if I tell that some example, if I tell some example barrier to trade, certain items are not supposed to sell to certain people, okay, or certain region. That is also a barrier. Another is a, say for an example, now we are, there are a lot of goods coming from China. Now India added some more tax and constraint to China items, additional anti-dumping duties charged on into China product. This is called barrier to trade. It's not allowing free trade. There are certain barriers are added, called barrier to trade. Another is a benchmarking. Say for doing certain things, you set a certain standards. That standard setting is called benchmarking. A minimum standard, you are thinking or telling that if I do some transaction or something, product, build a product, these are the basic things need to be there in that particular item. A standard setting is called benchmarking. Brand, okay, brand, next is a brand equity. Brand equity means the value of your brand. Okay, normal, you have a product, it have a value, you are selling at it. Any additional value commands your product because of that name attached to it is called a brand equity. So for an example, Apple is one of the world most brand equity item. Similar with a mobile with similar features, you will get for 20,000, 25,000, but an Apple you will get for 50,000, 60,000. That means they have a lot of brand value because that value put together is called a brand equity. It's a business model. Business model means in any business, they have a structure, an operation model. This is called a business model. Okay, then there is something called some shortcut called B2B and B2C. B2B means business to business. A set of business is there. They do transaction with another businesses, not to a end customer. Then there is a concept called B2C, business to customers. Okay, they will directly do business to customers, not to another wholesaler. Previously, this is called a wholesale and retail. Now it is B2B and B2C. Consortium. Consortium means a group of business entity comes together and forms a special purpose vehicle to do a certain business activity. It is called consortium. For an example, you may be hearing that L&T and some other organization put together, come and bid for a consortium to build a big railway track or a bridge. This is called consortium. Corporate culture. Corporate culture means in any organization, they have certain standard values, the way it is functioning. Those set of rules and regulations, standard processes, put together, it's called corporate culture. If you say example, everybody will tell that Infosys is a company having a corporate culture. That means we all know that they will behave in a certain manner in kind of certain situations. Cross-selling. Cross-selling means you have a certain amount of customers, certain customer for the product you are having. Suddenly, you are thinking that I am having a certain customer, let me explore some other product also sell to these customers. Then this is called additionally selling a different product to your existing customer. It's called cross-selling. Differentiation. Differentiation means distinguishing two set of customers. Say you have a certain customers and based on certain things, you are differentiating. Say, for example, many, especially FMCG sector, they will do based on the sex, male and female product classification, they will do that differentiation. You will do based on the age category, children and adult, there will be different kind of products. These are called differentiation. Then another something called FMCG, that is fast moving consumer goods. Fast moving consumer goods means those items which are non-durable. One time you are using, say for example, paste. Once you buy and use it, it's all over. Then again, you will buy. That is called or food items. All of your food items coming under fast-moving consumer goods, biscuits, rice, dal, all those items comes under FMCG. Internal marketing. Say for an example, you are selling in among your employees. Say for example, you are selling certain product. You are selling to your own employees at a different price. It's called internal marketing. Market development. Market development is a creating a demand for your product is called a market development. You currently you are introducing a new product or an existing product. You are previously selling in three states in Uttar Pradesh, Bihar, and Maharashtra. Now you are enrolling. You are making your product available in Gujarat. Also, this is called market development. New market is Gujaratis. We are planning to develop for market development. Market segmentation. That's what another thing I was talking about, differentiation. This is market segmentation also come. This segmentation can be geographical. It can be, say, for example, South India, North India, Central India. You have creating market segmentation. Or you are creating a market segmentation based on the age group, child, adult, or young, old age people. That can be, or based on a sex, it will be male and female area. This is called market segmentation. It can be any way of grouping. Next is a price discrimination. Say, for an example, for same product, different market, you sell at different price. This is called price discrimination for different reasons. It may be, look and say, for example, some market, the cover layout will be different based on appealing to say for a women product, mostly it will be pink and related colors. Men, it will be other colors. This is all, and charges a different price. It is called a price discrimination. Next is a price elasticity of demand. Okay, price matrix is there. Price marketing mix. Marketing mix means, say for example, you have a different kind of market. Say, or you have a direct market, you are having online market is there. There are online people are asking online, you are delivering through other delivery mechanism. There is something like that. Then you have a retail segment where a consumer comes and buy. Then this is called your marketing mix. Different channels you are using, and for that you have a marketing mix. It can be that way around. It can be a product also. You have a 5-6 products. Then that can also form as a marketing mix. Next is a price elasticity of demand. That means based on the price of your product, the sale of your item can increase or decrease. If that is there, then it is called price elasticity of demand. Say for an example, if you are selling buy one, get one free, say one big concept is showing like that. Buy two, get one free. It's all price elasticity. Testing the customers that. Say for an example, 100 rupees, one item, you may buy one. But if you are telling that 120 rupees, you will get two, then people will be buying for that. Then you are able to sell your additional item. That is called the price elasticity. Based on the price change, the consumer consumes more or less based on that price change, it is called price elasticity of demand. There is another concept called price skimming. This is mostly done in case of a new products are introduced in the market. They will keep absorbently high price. Say for an example, when an iPhone new is introduced, always they will keep at the high price because there are certain niche customers. They don't mind the cost, but they want to buy immediately at the earliest. Then this strategy is called price skimming. Then there is one concept called unique selling proposition, USP. Okay, this is a USP. Normally, also you are hearing this word, but this is a business concept as well. For any business, what is your fundamental idea of selling your item? That is called the unique selling proposition. Okay, there should be a value. Say for an example, now there are a lot of paste in the market for toothpaste. And one new product is coming and telling that ours is having a salt, which is cleans gem and kills all gems. It's something called that is called their unique selling proposition. can be anything. It can be a taste of you are having the taste of mango tree, which is the mango leaves. Mango leaves was previously used for cleaning your teeth. Now this is our product is with that. That is called a unique selling proposition. Whatever can be, it can be anything. Next is a certain banking related terminologies also we will discuss. And okay, banking related technology. One is accrued interest, an interest which is not paid directly, but to say for an example, you invested certain amount in your bank account, and after every month or quarter, they will send a statement telling that this is interest. That means that interest added to your investment. That's called accrued interest. Then something called American depository receipt. I think it's not that relevant, but I will still tell you. And American depository receipt means it's a certain amount of shares of a foreign company traded in an American stock exchange. Okay, this is called American depository receipt. So for an example, Tata Motors is traded, Infosys is, and TCS all traded in US Nasdaq stock exchange, which is called ADR, Infosys ADR. Tata Motors ADR. Basis point. Basis point means 100th of a percentage is called basis point. Sometimes you will hear that Reserve Bank of India increased the interest rate 100 basis point or reduced the repo rate by 100 basis point. This is something called that. Basis point means 100th of a percentage. Letter of credit. Letter of credit is a guarantee or assurance given by bank on behalf of his customer to a supplier. A supplier is in a different country, he's selling to a customer, he don't know whether the customer will pay or not. Then this customer's bank will ensure as a guarantee telling that at the end of the 3 months period, I will ensure that you will receive your payment. This is called letter of credit. Mortgage. Mortgage means a guarantee which is given getting a financial value or credit. Repo rate and reverse repo rate, I think I mentioned earlier that repo rate is the amount rate at which RBI lends loans to commercial banks, and reverse repo rate is the rate at which commercial banks can deposit the money in Reserve Bank of India. Lock-in period. Lock-in period is also a period, say for an example, if you are buying a debentures, then they will tell that after 3 years only it will be redeemed or repaid. That period is called a lock-in period. A few other business terminologies also. Bankruptcy. Bankruptcy means insolvency. The person is not in a position to repay the debt he is owning, then called it bankruptcy. Bottom line. Bottom line means it's a colloquial term always using that in a profit and loss account there is a sales minus your cost of production or a cost of sales, then it's called you will get a gross profit minus your operating expenses. It is then you will get a net profit. That's the bottom line means the last line, that line is coming. What is called net profit? Your net profit is called bottom line. Corporate governance. Governance means there are certain rules and regulations which a company follows to continue their day-to-day operations is called corporate governance. Goodwill, which you were talking about, the value of a company which cannot be seen, but you can get an economic yield or benefit based on the additional value exists for that company. It's an intangible asset. We were discussing that. That's called goodwill. Joint products and byproducts. Certain product items are produced, then it can have a joint products coming in or a byproducts also. Joint products means when you produce certain things, the equally quality different items with a equal economic value is coming, then it is called joint products. Say for an example, then petroleum. When petroleum is processed, you will get a diesel, kerosene, petrol, all these products are called joint products. Same process, you will get a different outputs of almost equal value. It's called joint products. Then there is something called byproduct. Say for an example, you are sugar mill industries using sugar cane. They produce sugar. Alongside, they will get an item called molasses. It's a byproduct. It's a less in value. Mostly the discharge of the sugar production, it is called a byproduct. By this, I'll finish the formal section. I think time is up. If you would like, we can BCQ. I think you can refer yourself. No need of I'm separately discussing those things, right?
Yes, sir.
See, MCQ, there are MCQs part of your two worksheets. Do we want to discuss that one, or you are fine with it and you can refer yourself? If you have any questions related to the area which we discussed, we can have a discussion on that. Yeah. Or any other things which you would like to have.
Okay, sir.
Or if you have nothing, any Vivek? Are you there? How he had any plan how to conclude his talk? Anything? No? One second, I'll call him how to finish it off. You have some doubt? Anything? If you can ask, not an issue.
Okay, sir. If I come across any doubts, I will message in WhatsApp. It's okay for you, sir.
Yeah, no problem. Absolutely. You can get back to me of anything related to the area I've taken or any other area also. If you have any doubt, you can get back to me. Absolutely fine.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Nothing else? We'll close for the day?
Okay, sir.
Okay. Thank you very much.